Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee of 2024. The convener is unable to attend today's meeting physically and will be joining us remotely, so I will be convening the meeting as deputy convener, and I have received no apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is two evidence sessions on the Abortion Services Safe Access Zones Scotland Bill. And as Gillian Mackay is the member in charge of the bill, Gillian will not participate in the committee's scrutiny of the bill by virtue of Rule 9.13 alpha point 2 brackets B. Therefore, Mr. Ross Greer will attend in her place as a committee substitute by virtue of Rule 12.2 alpha point 2. Our first evidence session is to explore the impact of the bill for those providing abortion services, and I welcome our guests to the meeting. All are here in person today. Professor Sharon Cameron, Consultant in Gynaecology and Sexual and Reproductive Health, the Chalmers Sexual Health Service in NHS Lothian. Colin Pullman, Director of the Royal College of Nursing in Scotland. And Dr. Chris Provan, Chair of the Royal College of General Practitioners in Scotland. Thank you very much for coming. And Linda Hodges, representing the Private Hospital Abortion Services Managers, was due to give evidence this morning but has given her apologies, and we will therefore engage in written correspondence. So we'll move straight to questions from members, and I'd like to invite Ivan McKee to begin.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning, panel. A couple of areas I'd just like to explore on. First one was the more general aspect of whether you or your colleagues have encountered protests at the workplace, and what impact that has or can have on staff. So a general question. I don't know if you want to can answer that in turn.
So I can start. So I'm based in Chalmers, which is an integrated sexual and reproductive health service in Edinburgh city centre. It's on the site of the old Royal Infirmary, beside a high school, university, shops, busy road, buses, etc. And it provides a whole range of sexual and reproductive health services, not just abortion care, but also gynaecological services, menopausal services, comprehensive contraception, HIV care, gender identity care. I could go on. But since 2011, we've been providing abortion services to probably over 2,400 women in the region. The protests that we've had have tended to occur on Monday mornings. They have been a group, maybe on average four, and round about 2018, it increased up to eight individuals who would be standing or leaning against a wall on the public street, separated from the patient entrance of Chalmers by a fairly busy road. And they were men and women, a little bit older in general, probably over the age of 50. The protests didn't occur every week. They took the form of a display of images, of fetuses, placards, anti-abortion messages. The protesters would sometimes walk up and down the street and along the entrance into the Chalmers, the patient entrance, handing out anti-abortion literature to passers-by, to those accessing the clinics and to the high school students in the adjacent school. And the activity tended to increase during Lent. In 2020, we had nocturnal illumination of images, anti-abortion message, including a fetus projected onto the building. There has been a lull in activity, and I've not been aware of any protesters since before Christmas. But I can tell you about the impact that it's been having. Some of it is indirect through the impact that it's had on the patients, with women attending the clinics being clearly distressed. Others phoning up in advance of a consultation because they're anxious. They're anxious about entering the building. They're worried about protesters. They're worried about maybe media being there, being filmed, being watched. Some women who perhaps by virtue of the way they dress, which might link them to a particular group or minor ethnic group, were particularly anxious about entering. And feeling judged and being identified from the protests, and patient feedback that we were getting at the time was that they were feeling targeted, anxious and harassed. And so this was impacting on staff. Staff were concerned about the patients feeling intimidated by the presence of the protesters, that they may be less likely to access the services. And also, as I've said already, our service provides a whole range of services, including young people, but other vulnerable groups, and they were worried that that might deter others from coming. The protesters are outside other clinical buildings, such as the dental hospital, and outside and adjacent to the eye pavilion. So there's concern among staff that they may be intimidating patients who might be deterred from using those services as well. They're in close vicinity to the public high school and handing out distressing and false information. And then there's a direct effect on staff. The staff have felt frustrated about the presence of the protesters and that we are powerless to do anything about them, that they feel frustrated that it's unacceptable that they're protesting about an essential healthcare service outside a healthcare clinic. As I've said already, they're anxious and concerned about putting off patients attending our services. It has resulted in additional workload for staff and logistical changes, not only the anxiety about preparing when we know that there's going to be protesters, but in some circumstances having to use staff to divert patients from the patient entrance to use the staff entrance, and of course then through the building you have to use security cards, and this can take up time and energy, having to plan perhaps for if there's going to be a lot of protesters present, whether women who are going to be collecting, for example, medication for early medical abortion, whether we might have to change where they have their medication pickup, and we've had to spend time planning to look at other clinics where they might be able to pick up medication, and also consider whether we use services such as courier services, which also has additional costs. So there's been a lot of time and effort put into planning how to maintain activity in the face of these protests. It's also caused a chill in staff. Staff are frightened, have been frightened at times about their safety, and we're all well aware of cases, particularly in the USA, or rather in the USA, where abortion providers have been targeted and some have been killed and shot. Abortion care is already a stigmatised area as well. There's good evidence that staff that work in abortion services may not tell family and friends about what they do. And this is adding to that and adding to staff feeling that their role is undervalued. As I said already, bringing patients in through staff entrances, it's all logistically challenging. And then finally, we find that when protests are occurring, it may attract other groups who are well-meaning and want to come and protect the patients. But the net effect of that is you're then having two groups of protesters in a rather busy area. As I've said, you know, there's buses, it's a busy street, there's other clinical services, there's a high school next door. And you can get the impression that you're working with a circus outside. Patients, it's not very conducive to patients coming in for their appointment for fear that their privacy may not be guaranteed. And, you know, it does take some courage, particularly for some individuals to attend a clinic appointment in the first place. The protesters may be there on a regular basis for a spell and then they may not come for months. I've said already I've not been aware of any since before Christmas. And whilst that has been lovely and it's been great just to get on with business as usual, there's still always that, you know, niggle at the back of your head and that chilling factor. When are they going to come back?
Thank you. Colin?
Yeah, on the back of Professor Cameron, I mean, our members report the same. The real issues around about the unpredictability does cause anxiety for people attending, especially in relation to the patient, but more in respect of our members and attending work. A number have reported to us, you know, they never get used to people being around with, especially the leaflets and such that they're shown. That in itself is quite distressing, having to pass that quite closely, having to go to your work just to get on with your work to provide healthcare. And you know, members report again that it's not happening all the time, but actually in some ways that makes it worse. That makes it worse that you don't have a predictability is going to happen. And then again, the impact it has on colleagues and supporting each other in relation to when it is happening and some of the things that are said and some of the things that are taken into the workplace, and people are then, of course, it creates an atmosphere in the clinics as well, and staff report that actually puts everybody on a bit tension in relation to when they're providing care, because that in itself is not good for the patients who are going through a difficult time, and of course are accessing healthcare. That's what they're doing, and our members just want to provide healthcare and the best that they can for the clients that they deal with. So there is a direct impact, I think. Professor Cameron's given you an absolute insight into the day-to-day of that. But I think the one thing I would say, one of our members, it sticks in my head, she would say, you're always shocked and surprised when they're there. You're shocked, but, you know, never totally surprised, but you never get used to it. It's just continually distressing and it wears people down, especially if it's happening on a continued basis. So I think we can never ignore the impact on the members of staff as well as the impact on the patients.
Thanks. Chris?
Thank you. I'd just like to support Professor Cameron's views and experience. I've not known any protests at primary care premises. There was the example I'm thinking of is the Queen Elizabeth Hospital in 2018, I think it was, where there was demonstrations outside where you could hear that in the waiting room. And in this situation, women are going through complex emotions and should really be able to lawfully go ahead seeking health care in an atmosphere which is not tense, with an atmosphere for patients with noise disturbance. So we fully support that. It may actually just emphasise delay, women coming forward, and it's best to go ahead in these situations as early as possible to prevent clinical complications and emotionally as well, most likely. Just to think that there's not a clear definition now between hospitals and other healthcare premises. So I think we have to be thinking ahead around what we define as a protected area, because often GP practices can co-locate with other sexual health services, and we want to be able to allow patients to access all of these services. So in Northern Ireland, I understand they have a wider definition of areas that provide information, advice or counselling. So just to make that general point about where we cover and look ahead with this, so we anticipate where protests might occur.
Thanks very much. Just a couple of points to follow up on that. Your reference to counter demonstrators was interesting in that regard, in terms of the atmosphere that creates as well. And it was also a couple of you mentioned false information being given out. So I'd like to understand some examples of the types of false information that is given out in the protests.
Well, usually the leaflets will show pictures, images of a very advanced fetus. And that's very emotive. And, you know, the vast majority of the women that are attending the services are coming at a very early stage of abortion. And the leaflets will also have false facts about the long-term effects of abortion. You know, there's good evidence, and we have guidelines from the RCOG and NICE that have looked at the best evidence that show that, you know, there are no long-term effects of abortion in terms of no adverse effect on fertility or breast cancer, and yet the literature that's being given out will allude to facts such as that.
And the other
false facts, false myths, misconceptions.
In terms of what you've identified, yeah. The other question that's come up, and just get some clarity on this, it was raised in the session last week, the information that is provided within the clinics, within the settings by staff, around about options for patients, for women coming in.
So women, if they're unsure of their decision, they have the option to discuss that further, to get support decision-making support, and for women, for whatever reason, after an abortion, maybe struggling. Women can feel a variety of emotions, but there's also post-abortion counselling available through the NHS.
Okay, so that thing. The last point I was going to raise, convener, was round about the exemptions on trade union activity, picketing, because clearly we're working our way through this and there's human rights challenges on many sides. So just to understand your perspective on the rationale behind a potential trade union exemption and what was in the bill with regard to whether you thought that met those requirements, because clearly the right to trade union activity is a fundamental human right, as is the right to protest. So just understand how we unpick that in your perspective.
I think I'll pick that up probably best. In respect to the proposals that are in the bill, and of course it covers predominantly picketing, and the ability to be able to carry out picketing as detailed in other legislation. I think it could be looked at, it's written quite narrowly, and I think you potentially need to look at the broader issues around about trade union activity leading up to, for example, a potential ballot, for example, or trying to engage with your membership. So I think there needs to be some careful consideration of how that's been drafted, because, it needs to be done in a very... And trade unions and professional organisations are very... are very aware of where our members work. And when we're actually doing trade union activity, we make sure that we're not impacting on individuals who are going to get care or whatever. That's very clear and very clear in our best practice guidance and such like. But what we think that the legislation at the moment, as it's drafted, is probably too narrow. It just covers picketing in itself, and it should maybe look at the wider activity around about, especially building up to potentially an industrial dispute, for example. Mm.
Is there a risk that trade union activity can cause the same kind of concerns that we've identified on existing protests?
I think the issue is the trade union activity is, and of course I'm biased because I'm from a trade union professional organisation, and we're covered by very clear legislation that makes us behave in reasonable ways when it comes to conducting a trade dispute, and that's covered in other legislation, UK legislation, which we of course adhere to absolutely by the letter. Okay. So from the point of view of it, I think comparing it is very different in respect of trade union activities. Usually we're looking to speak to our members, not to the patients who are coming through the front door.
OK, thanks very much for clarifying that. Thank you, convener.
Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Just to follow up on that a bit, and I totally acknowledge that these are different things and activity with different aims. However, I suppose if I reflect on what Professor Cameron said about women perhaps feeling uncomfortable that there might be media attention, there might be cameras there, actually walking past any group of people could be a little bit, could be distressing, no matter, you know, what they're doing. Can you just expand a bit more on how member, you know, is it, would union members picket a sexual and reproductive health clinic?
I think, well, it's never happened to my knowledge in the amount of years that we've taken, and not just in Scotland, across the UK, we've not actually picketed these kind of clinics. Because there's not been a trade dispute in that spirit of respect. But that doesn't mean it wouldn't happen. Mm-hmm. And I think the issues around about, for picketing itself, there's very clear legislation of what you can do about egress, access. The difference, with all due respect, in relation to this is around about the kind of images and such like that people put on placards and such like. That mm-hmm. absolutely wouldn't be the case. You know, you may have placards, but it's usually with a message of, dare I say it, about more pay or whatever. But I wouldn't compare the two, obviously.
So I suppose just to press a little further, and I'll maybe bring in Professor Cameron, this bill will include people that don't have placards. It'll include people silently doing their vigil or their praying or whatever they want to call it. So there are... it's still women having to walk through a group of individuals to access their healthcare. Do you have any comment on that, Professor Cameron?
So, you know, they do walk up and down the street and they do approach people walking by. At times, I know in our service, they have come into the even into the reception. People coming know who they are and what they're doing, and that's distressing. And if the media report it, the media are going to be reporting it as, you know, these are the anti-abortion protesters outside the clinic, and you're caught on film, or you're worried that you're going to be caught. It doesn't matter whether they're quiet, they're doing these activities and approaching people, and their presence is a chilling one, mm-hmm. and it's unpredictable.
Okay, thank you,
Dr. Sandesh Gahani.
Thank you. And just to declare my register of interest as a practicing NHS GP, and particularly pertinently at this, I'm a member of the RCGP. So I've got basically the same question for Colin and for Chris. Colin, in your submission, it says the RCN Scotland supports the intention behind the bill. Can I ask you clearly, do you support the bill as it is written?
Well, we would like to see, so for example, we think that the clarification in relation to the activity around about the build-up to a trade dispute and a ballot needs to be thought about in relation to the draft then. But in relation to the bill and the principles of it and where the bill sits in relation to the exclusions, yeah, we do support it.
Sorry, could you just explain the ballot part of your...
So in relation to, if leading up, so it's very clear the exemption is there in relation to picketing itself, and that's very clear, it's described. But we believe that that there needs to be some thought, so there's not any, how can you put it, unpredicted, unintended consequences. So for example, leading up to, within a trade dispute, you would generally go and speak to staff within that environment to talk about the trade dispute, the options, and whether you were going for a ballot, for example, because, as you know, we have very tight trade union legislation that we need to go through in relation to carrying out industrial action. So you would want to have the ability to go and speak to staff to have that discussion. And if it's as narrow as at this moment, we believe there could be some unintended consequences that some employers, for example, could then turn around and say, well, you know, you're covered under this legislation, although it's not trade union act, you know, it's not trade union activity that you're not, we're not protesting about the provision of the services or whatever. They could use that. They could misuse this potential in the act. And that's why we think the provisions need to be just carefully considered when drafting.
Okay. Thank you very much. That's something we can certainly pick up panel two. And Chris, you in your submission, it says the RCGP Scotland agrees with the purpose of the proposed bill. So the same question, do you agree with the bill as it is worded?
I think yes, in the general principles of the bill, as far as allowing women, as far as women's health plan to have easier access to these services and not being discouraged from that, and supporting staff. So we fully support all of those aspects of it, and also the type of protest, the silent protest. Really appreciate that can be intimidating, so it's a difficult thing to define, but any sort of presence in that area can be intimidating and potentially will discourage women coming forward. I've mentioned about the definition of areas covered, because one of the consequences may be that protests move to other areas in primary care, aftercare and counselling and other services can occur there. So we have to think about that knock-on effect. Patients should also be able to access other services, which are often co-located, as I say, around sexual health services, rape crisis, counselling and support services, all of these other things. There should be no barriers to that. Is what we put in the submission there.
Thank you. Ross Greer.
Thanks. Excuse me. Thanks, Convener. Just like to pick up on a couple of Ivan McKee's questions. And Colin, just first of all, for yourself on this question of impact on trade union activity short of picketing, accepting what you said, that none of us can think of an instance where there has been this kind of industrial action at a facility providing abortion services. In other settings, though, where your members have taken industrial action across the UK, is it common to get complaints from patients about a perceived impact on them upon entering a facility if there is a picket line outside? Can you recall patients complaining about
well,
that?
Well, we've just been through an intense period of industrial action across the UK, and I have to say it's the very reverse. Normally, yeah. Patients are very complimentary and very supportive. I think, you know, in the industrial action in England and Wales and Northern Ireland, I think we had one situation where a member of the public had took umbrage to people picketing, but there was no issues around about egress access. And in fact, you know, that it was found because we investigated it further. So that it's not something that's been an issue brought to our attention.
Thanks very much. And Professor Cameron, just following up on what you were saying in response to Ivan around the support that's provided, those who engage in these protests say one of their key reasons for doing so is that they're providing an alternative that they don't believe is provided within the healthcare setting, a discussion about alternatives to abortion. I was wondering if you could just expand a little bit on your answer to Ivan McKee around the process and the support that is actually available to a woman who's come seeking abortion services or reproductive healthcare services.
Yeah. So I guess to start off, you know, we know from evidence that the vast majority of women know what they're going to do as soon as they've had that positive pregnancy test. We know that for women who come seeking abortion, that most of them are sure of their decision, but there is a proportion that are not. And, you know, services do exist to be able to provide counselling to women who are unsure of their decision. We also see women who may want to end the pregnancy, but it may not be a pregnancy that's continuing. So the services also manage women who present find out to have a miscarriage. And we also have, you know, many women who decide that they are going to continue their pregnancy. And the services support those women. That's one of the beauties of the Scottish NHS. We've got all these links. You know, we're part of, you know, the services we have, sexual and reproductive health services, you know, their NHS services, they've got good links with hospitals. Some of the abortion services are actually set in hospitals and they're run by the departments of obstetrics and gynaecology, and often it's the same staff that are working in the early pregnancy units or working in maternity, depending on the size of the hospital. So we've got really good links. So if people, you know, want to continue their pregnancy, we can support them in that decision. You know, they can be supported to then access antenatal care. For women who are discovered to have a miscarriage, we can support them. We can link in with early pregnancy units. For those who turn out to have a pregnancy outside the uterus, an ectopic pregnancy, they can be supported too. That's one of the beauties of the Scottish NHS. But also we do have, you know, internal counselling services by staff who can provide support around decision making, as well as I said, for the minority of women who afterwards are struggling and need ongoing support. You know, it's a decision that for many women is one that they're sure of. For some women, it's one that they're not sure of, but they make that decision and they may later regret it, like many life decisions that we have to make. But you know, we have the services to be able to support these women both before, if they continue with the pregnancy, and after if they're struggling.
Thanks very much. You mentioned the leaflet that committee members are aware of, the most common one that includes misinformation about things like risk of breast cancer. Mm-hmm. Have you seen examples of that having an impact, of that being handed to a woman who's seeking an abortion and your staff then having to have a discussion other than the one that was expected because there are concerns about the information in the leaflet?
So the staff have reported that, yes, that there have been occasions where women have been upset and they've shown them the leaflet, and then yes, that does take additional time to try and support them, calm them, and provide, make sure that they're getting evidence-based, true responses, and they're not feeling intimidated, harassed into continuing with a pregnancy that they don't want to continue and that they can't continue.
Thanks. And just finally, Chris, I'm interested in your response as well to the claim that the protesters put out that what they're doing is providing alternative support, alternative information.
Yeah, I would clearly disagree with that. Often patients come to us because they have an existing relationship, and that's supportive before and after, potentially around counselling. Our role is really to give the woman information so that non-judgmentally she can make that decision in her particular circumstances, on that particular woman's individual circumstances, what she wants to do. And these protests contain information which is scientifically incorrect, and we should prevent that so that we can have healthcare professionals who are trained and experienced in doing this, and also doing it in an atmosphere, as I've said, where it's calm and they can think these things through rather than being anxious because they've been through a protest, obviously.
Thanks very much. And you make a key point. The protesters outside are not themselves qualified healthcare professionals. Thanks, Convener.
David Torrance.
Convener, good morning. We probably all know answers to the question I'm going to ask, but just to make sure it's on the record for committee, the introduction of access zones, what impact does it have on people, accessing abortion services, people accessing other services at the facility, and staff providing healthcare services and passerbys? What impact would it have?
Well, staff are concerned that the presence of the protesters might be deterring individuals from accessing our services. Now, obviously, abortion services may be delivered in Scotland within a hospital setting, that they may be delivered within sexual and reproductive health services. Sexual and reproductive health services in particular might be providing a wide range of services to a wide range of individuals with vulnerabilities, young people. Just one particular group, and you know there is concern that the protesters might be putting off individuals who might struggle to access services from attending. You know, it's really important we do as much as we can in Scotland and the rest of the UK to improve access to sexual health, and the presence of protesters is working against that. It's also important that for women who do want to have an abortion, that they can access that as soon as possible, because there is very good evidence that, you know, abortion at earlier gestations is associated with fewer complications and less pain and less bleeding, etc. It's also possible that the presence of the protesters might be deterring individuals from accessing not just the services within our building, but services in surrounding buildings. You know, we have the dental hospital that have been right outside. Are they putting off individuals accessing the dental hospital? Are they putting off individuals accessing care at the Eye Pavilion? Are they putting off individuals, the passers-by? Are they causing them distress? So, you know, we would hope that this bill would prevent that.
Just to add, Professor Cameron, I think it's the whole issue of stigma and the impact that has on patients. And as Professor Cameron was saying about people, people are going there to access healthcare, but it's a difficult decision. It's a very emotional time for both the patients and their loved ones. And these kind of protests can have a potential impact. And as I said before, it also has an impact on the staff on a day-to-day basis, having to go past and actually be made to feel that your work, there's something wrong with the work that you're providing when you're only providing what is the best healthcare that you can provide, and compassionate care for people. So it's the whole issues around about that stigma and made to feel that you're maybe not, you know, doing something that is worthwhile or whatever. That's how it comes across for people. And that over a period of time can have quite a wearing impact on people in relation to coming to their work. And I think that needs to be understood as well, as I say, for the patients. In relation to by dint of where services are placed, it could have an impact, because at the end of the day, somebody may say, well, you know, I know there's a protest there, I'm due to get healthcare, actually, I don't want to go near there for whatever reasons. Because it's a very personal thing, isn't it, in relation to that, and made to feel, because again, people might feel that they'll be asked their views, and that might have an impact on them as well.
Yeah, so I would agree with what has been said. We want to improve access and prevent delays, especially for more vulnerable groups, which can be people from less well-off environments financially, and also rural areas. So there's evidence that we want to continue to improve access around there, and that can interfere with that. The British Society of Abortion Providers pointed out that some women may be tempted to actually go onto the internet and try and obtain drugs or go to non-regulated services, which obviously we don't know what is in these medications, and it's not a regulated service, so it's unsafe for them. There is, looking at evidence in Australia, there is evidence that these type of schemes do protect access, privacy, support staff, and prevent misinformation around that. So it's encouraging that there is some evidence around that.
Thank you.
Just one final point is around clinical staff. It's also about support staff and administrative staff. We should remember them as well.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Problem. Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you all, and thank you for being here today. You've talked a little bit already, Dr. Proven, about other premises other than actual abortion provider places, so GP practices, maybe even pharmacies. So, so just to, I suppose, get your thoughts about the definition of protected premises. Is there enough in the bill that could then be future-proofed or applied to other areas? Section 7 talks about extension of safe access zones and how Scottish ministers may approve an application made under Section 1. So is there enough information that would allow further sites to be part of safe access zones?
I think I'm not sure is the answer to that. I think that we want to be able to regulate in advance, in a sense, so that if the protest moves to, say, a GP practice, which previously wasn't covered by the definition, then you'd have to produce more informational regulation. So you want to actually get ahead of the game. So I think it's an area that needs to be perhaps looked at and seen what happens in other areas. I'm not an expert in that, but I think it's something that we need to think about, because very often there are many other counselling and other services around this which, as I say, may be affected.
Okay. And the 200-metre radius that's proposed in the bill, you know, I know that, you know, there will be places that would require wider than 200 metres or maybe different. So any thoughts about the 200 metres that's laid out in the bill?
I think flexibility is probably there. In some ways, depending on the individual circumstances of the healthcare facility and the situation. I think 200 metres... I don't know of the evidence around that, but it seems entirely appropriate.
Other legislation has 150 metres or 50 metres, but 200 is what has been proposed in this bill. I suppose any thoughts, Professor Cameron, from you about that? Because you were talking about it's a really busy place, there's a high school next door, so that might be something that we have to consider as well.
Yes, and I think that's important that the 200 would be probably a minimum, and that there would be flexibility to increase that and to be able to consider new sites of delivery for abortion care. You know, technology advances, health service delivery advances, you know, there's been a lot of advances during the pandemic. It's not inconceivable that in the future some services could be delivered from general practice, which is a model in Ireland, from pharmacies, which is a model in Canada, you know, particularly in remote and rural areas. And so I think, you know, we need to be cognizant and make sure this bill is future-proofed so that we're not in a situation where we're trying to improve access to those living in far, far away places, and we find that the very healthcare delivery site that can provide them with their care is surrounded by abortion protesters.
Okay. And, I mean, spoke about extension, but what about reduction of safe zones? I think I read in the briefing that we need to be, I suppose, how would that work if there were certain future ministers that were against abortion? How do we make sure that the extension and reduction is going to be able to be continued and provide safe access zones?
I can't see that it could be reduced. Thinking about the services that I'm familiar with, a 50 metre zone is far too short.
Okay.
Can I come in on that point actually about the zones and extension of the zones? And it's actually the point in relation to where, for example, an operator may not apply for an extension, and it's actually around about trade unions and professional organisations having an ability to seek an operator to apply to a minister, to ministers for an extension, because I think that might be important. And I think it does absolutely come down to local situations, because as we know, for example, the Queen Elizabeth, there's quite complexities around about where the clinic is. It's not a standalone clinic, it's within a set environment, and these are the kind of things that we think that you should have the ability, and I think from a trade union point of view, we'd very much like the ability to have discussions with an operator of a service, and actually an obligation for them in the legislation to consider that, to consider an application if we were to approach them on that.
Okay, just a final wee question. Professor Cameron, you talked about women having to go in through the back door of a premise. And so I suppose the zone area that's defined in whatever place should obviously include whatever detail is required in a particular premises to allow, you know, that the ability to access safely through the front door and not have to do the whole safe access, ID badges, escorting people through all of that.
Absolutely.
Yep. Okay. Thank you.
Still, Togana, do you have any other questions?
Thank you. I just wanted to pick up, Chris. You talk about protesting outside potential GP practices. I mean, we all do abortion in some way, whether that's referral or asking our colleague to take a patient if you've got a conscientious objection to it. So I mean, if you were to have 200 metres around every GP practice, wouldn't that be quite a lot?
It is, and that's part of the difficulty. And for this bill is defining that. Because we all have some involvement, which is a really important involvement around the counselling around this. So it's just bringing up that point for people to consider that balance around that and how far you go with it. And that's why I said I'm not an expert, because I don't necessarily have a clear answer to that question, to be honest. But we need a flexible way of actually anticipating and making this future-proof. And where abortions occur in the future may be less definable, because often a lot of this can be done over the phone or remotely to some extent. I think we have to be clear that GP premises are protected rapidly if protests start to happen outside them. But it's really up to the detail of the bill how they do that. I hope that makes sense.
Absolutely. And can I ask any of the panel members about their opinions? So we have our 200-metre zone, and in the legislation that is put before us, that includes people's own residence as to what happens in their own residence. And I would like to hear your opinion about the decision potentially to start saying what people can and cannot do in their homes, given that, you know, you are banning, you know, big pictures, say, you know, in the street and picketing of a fetus. And it does seem sensible to sort of include that. But my understanding is that it's the only one that includes people's homes, but this is also somebody's own private residence. So your opinions on that, please.
Yeah, my opinion is that it's a balance of rights and responsibilities, and I think it is women's right to have health care in a non-judgmental way, and without being deterred in any way from that, especially if they're in a vulnerable situation for whatever reason. So I think that we would not want a scenario where there are pictures put up in somebody's house because they've actually within a zone. So we would support the bill in that stance.
I mean, just to add to Chris's position, is clearly there needs to be a balance between protecting the right for people to have a private conversation in their home, and but there needs to be the balance of the right of the patients and the staff to access their services without seeing distressing images and such like. For that reason, we do think the bill's obviously attends to that. The other thing is the unintended consequence. If you were to make any other provisions around about private dwellings, you could have people who try to use that as a loophole in the legislation, and I think that would be something you would really need to consider, i.e. one of these, you know, a campaigning organisation from either side of the debate could buy a private dwelling and turn it into some sort of HQ, and that certainly would defeat the purposes of the bill.
And just to add to that, you know, I alluded to earlier the how during 2020 there was a nocturnal illumination from across the street that was projected onto the building of Chalmers, with the distressing images around abortion, and I think that would be covered in the bill. From, you know, that cannot be tolerated. That was really distressing for the staff and the patients and patients attending the services.
Thank you.
Okay. Ruth McGuire, do you have any further questions?
Just on the next section.
Sure.
Yeah. So I want to ask about criminal offences and penalties in the bill, and I appreciate it might not be your area of expertise, but I would value your opinions. Some opponents of the bill have raised concerns that the behaviour captured in Section 4 criminal offence is wide-ranging and unclear. Do you have any views on the clarity of the actual offence as described in the bill?
I'll go first. I don't have a view. It's not an area of expertise. I think yourself as parliamentarians probably have a better view of that in relation to your wide view that you deal with. So I wouldn't want to offer any observation in relation to it. It's not an area where I'm either expert or knowledge.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we've already heard about silent vigils and actually physically blocking people and those types of activity. So I think we would support preventing those types of activities, although they are quite broad. I think you have to be clear that kind of silent vigil would still be very intimidating, would be our view. So we support what's in the bill.
Okay, thank you. David?
Again, not my area of expertise, so would defer to yourselves, but would think that for repeated offences, that would be more serious. Okay. There's also been concern expressed from those that have experienced regular abortion protests in England, that the fines may not be sufficient to deter those who are supported by well-funded anti-abortion organisations.
Okay, thank you, that's helpful. As that was quite briefly, can I just, we have alluded to in the session the different groups of citizens that access sexual and reproductive health. I just think it would be helpful to understand who's most impacted by the stigma and by being put off, which of our people. I suppose I'm thinking back to when the FGM bill, the Female Genital Mutilation Bill, came through this Parliament, and many minority ethnic women that we spoke with actually had trouble or found it difficult to access sexual and reproductive clinics just because of the breadth of services they were offering. So that group of individuals comes into my head when I think about people being put off, but I wonder if you could tell us about other groups.
So yes, that group, young people, those also who might not have the same skills to be able to navigate healthcare services, those with disabilities, and generally also women living at a distance as well.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Thanks, Karen.
Karen Walker.
Thank you, convener. Thank you. I want to just come back a wee bit to human rights, and I really value the views that you've given us so far, because I think that's come all the way through in the question, because of course it is important that we get this balance right for people. So I think, am I right in saying that you feel that the bill provides the sort of a proportional balance between the rights of people to express themselves but the protection of people coming along to get what is healthcare? Would you say the bill sets that out in a fair way?
Yes, I think we would support the measures in the bill. Yep, that's right.
Yeah. I think it's that issue. It's a really difficult one, but I think it's proportionate in the way that it's been laid down. Like anything, it'll be how the legislation is operated that will then prove through. But I think with the way it's laid down currently, we believe it's the right thing to do.
That's helpful, because the next point I wanted to is obviously the 200 metres, and we have had people discuss that, you know, operators of the bill should be able to increase it, you know, proportionally if they could. Some discussion about should it be able to be reduced in size. Do you have any view on that matter, Ms Cameron?
I can't see from at this current time, knowing the physical locations of services within hospitals and sexual reproductive health services, that it could be reduced. One could imagine maybe in the future that if services ceased to be offered altogether, then maybe that service might cease to be protected. But I think it's more likely, looking ahead to the future and how service delivery and technology might change, that there should be the flexibility for it to be expanded.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else on that particular issue?
No, I think it's a point that the operator should have. I raised the point before that I think as trade unions, professional organisations, we should have the ability to speak to an operator to look for an extension of it if we believe there's a reason for that to be put forward. But I think it should be for the operators to make a decision in relation to specific circumstances. I think it does come down to that circumstance. Of where somewhere is provided.
Yeah, no bother. I've got one more question, if that's all right, convener. I'm interested to know, some human rights organisations have suggested that ongoing operators should have to make sure the balance is correct and should be taking evidence from staff, you know, if there is any continual impact. How do you think that would play out in the future if operators did have to continue to speak to staff and look at the impacts of the ongoing provision of the bill? Would you have a view on that?
I potentially think operators should be speaking to staff anyway on a situation by situation basis to make sure that they're provided with the adequate support in relation to whatever is their part of it. Because as Chris actually pointed out, it's not just around about the clinicians who are providing the service, but it's a lot of other associated staff who work within services. Mm-hmm. So employers should have a duty to consult with their employees anyway around about the impact of whether it be the restrictions that are placed upon it or indeed any of the demonstrations that take place.
I would also like to add that it's really important that the the requirements on the service are not administratively heavy. Mm-hmm. You know, already the impact of the protesters, and I've already alluded to the workload around having to consider how we might change our operations to be able to provide service continuity. You know, that takes away from clinical care. Some services are larger than others. You know, in the Highlands and Islands, the services may be very, very small, and it's really not fair to expect providers who may be small in number, or those even who have got large staffing, to spend a lot of time and put a lot of administrative work into continually reviewing and completing forms and putting forward applications, particularly when we know that the protesters come and go. They may be there, you know, for a period of time. They may not come for months. So, you know, it's really important that it's as simple as possible.
It needs to be simple, and it shouldn't be responsibility of the staff there. There should be a right to seek healthcare services for patients without delay, and encouraging to reduce barriers there. So I wouldn't like to see having to prove that there's a problem before it's tackled. We should be anticipating it and preventing it in the first place.
That's helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sandesh Kalani.
Thank you. Professor Cameron, this is a question I will be putting to the to the solicitor who's coming a bit later, but if you have something that is distressing, or there are protesters, if this legislation is passed, somebody has to pick up the phone and call the police. And that somebody, whoever that might be, will have their name recorded. Do you feel that that might put off people, or has put off people, calling the police?
We know from feedback from our staff that sometimes patients don't want to call the police, even if they have been distressed by the presence of protesters, because they will be linked with having attended the service, perhaps in association with abortion. I think that if it's a member of staff that calls the police, then that I can't see that would be an issue, because already staff feel frustrated that they feel there's very little that they can do. So I think that they would be accepting of calling the police if the legislation was breached.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other matters that haven't been raised by members of the committee so far that you feel you need to express?
I'd like to say that prior to abortion being legalised in 1967, it was a leading cause of maternal death. And it's not anymore. And particularly with, you know, the advent of medical abortion and good access, and women being able to have access to medical abortion at very early stages of pregnancy, it's an extremely safe procedure. The WHO say it's essential healthcare. We need to protect access to this essential service. We don't want to go back in time, and we don't want to go back to seeing women being, you know, not being able to access this essential service. So I think it's really important to keep that in mind.
OK, thank you. Any other points from the members? Thank the witnesses for their contribution to the committee's work, and I now suspend this proceeding. Thank you. I call the meeting to order. We will continue our first agenda item today with a second evidence session on the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill. This session will explore the impact of the bill for those who will be responsible for enforcement and management of safe access zones. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting: Simon Brown, Vice President, Scottish Solicitors Bar Association; Superintendent Gerry Corrigan, Specialist Operations G Division at Police Scotland; Eddie Folan, Chief Officer of Health and Social Care for the Convention of Local Authorities in Scotland, COSLA; and Leslie Sharkey, Director of Midwifery, NHS Tayside; Sarah Wallage, Lead Clinician for Abortion at NHS Grampian. And we'll move to questions from members of the committee. Mr Ross Greer.
Thanks, Kinnear. I'd like to start off with a question to Sarah and Leslie, if that's OK. And just very much repeating, I'm not sure if you caught this section of the previous panel, but I'd be interested in your views around the misinformation that the protesters outside clinics share. The committee is aware of the most common leaflet, including misinformation around risk of breast cancer, etc., and the impact that that has, not just on those accessing services, but on your staff as well. Are your staff then having to have conversations to reassure patients about what they've seen in these leaflets? Because one of the core arguments that those protesting make is that they're offering alternative information and alternative support they don't believe is on offer inside your facilities.
So yes, it can have an impact on patients, not just for the protesters, but online information as well. I would argue that there is thorough information available online, particularly the new NHS Inform information site. But yes, we do sometimes find that we're having to counter misinformation, either with patients requesting abortion or with other people attending the service who mention it.
Thanks. Is it similar for yourself, Leslie, as well?
Yes, I suppose it's different from NHS Tayside's perspective in that there isn't a huge amount of protesters which are around it, and I'm sure we'll come on to that from our area specifically, but the area that Sarah picks up, especially around internet and information that you can receive from other women, whilst I understand that the bill doesn't cover that part of it, there's a variety of sources that people can get medical information from nowadays. So we would always be able to direct that to the medical professionals or specialist nurses and midwives that are providing that service as well. And some of that is a bit of about unpicking in societal attitudes around abortion and misconceptions that are on that as well. So it does have an impact around the country, but from a Tayside perspective, not a huge amount.
Yeah, you mentioned obviously that protests are largely, not entirely, but largely concentrated in Glasgow and Edinburgh, but because of social media as well as news coverage, people are aware of them across the country. Do you find that even in facilities where protests rarely or never take place, are women seeking to access your services aware of it? Do they perceive a risk, or is there worry and concern on their part about the fact that they might turn up and the day that they need to access your service is the day that 40 Days for Life are there?
Yes. We have few protests in Aberdeen or Grampian, but we have had patients with their first contact with the service, which is a telephone call, saying, and will there be protesters outside? So even though it's not happening locally, the fact that it's been reported and seen on the media is affecting people seeking to access the service.
Thanks.
Yeah, and very, very similar. I mean, it's been a number of years now from a Tayside perspective for where the actual protesters are outside the hospital or where the healthcare provider being for abortion services. But there is societies, I suppose, changed around abortion care. And we heard in that first session since like 50 years now since abortion law has been in place and for people to be able to access services such as. So one of the things I think that's really key and crucial for this bill especially is thinking about not just, we talked a lot, and certainly in your previous session last week as well, talked a lot around people accessing services right now, but what's the impact on people who may possibly have accessed services 30, 40 years ago, who may still be holding some trauma for that for moving forward as well, whether it's the woman themselves or it's families that have been involved in that and been able to come into hospital premises and either been confronted by imagery or people who are protesting, and what barrier does that put up? So whilst we are protecting the abortion services right at the present moment and future-proofing it. It is also the responsibility for healthcare for people who have already accessed our service as well.
Thanks very much. And just finally, if there is either a protest outside one of your facilities or threat of a protest, awareness that one might be coming up, what does that mean in practice for you? Do you have to do things differently? Do you have to provide different information to those accessing the service? What is the impact on you and your staff? How do you deal with either the protest or the threat of one?
So from a staff perspective, it's not just, I suppose we and it was picked up in the last session as well, we focus quite a lot on clinical staff who are actual providers of abortion care. But we also heard about admin staff, but I suppose from a porter and security staff as well within hospitals, they would often be the first response or first port of call if there was any concerns or concerns around any protests or for safety of staff as well. So we've got to think about that, and from a risk assessment perspective, what is the risks? But the first port of call and the initial perspective for staff would be, as we've heard, phone the police, contact security, phone the police, and then we would be looking to our police colleagues of Police Scotland College to be taking over that security aspect.
Thanks. Anything else you'd like to add, Sarah?
Yes, I agree. There'd be a sort of risk assessment of how we would manage the protest. It affects the whole building. It's not just the abortion service. It's everybody else working in that building, which for us includes cardiology, physio. A huge number of people could be affected. And yes, involving NHS security and making sure we've got contact for the police when needed.
Thanks very much. That takes us neatly on to the impact on Jerry, but we've colleagues will be covering that.
Feel free.
Yeah. Just in that instance, Jerry, a lot of this, when this became much more high profile, it's obviously gone on for a long time, but when this issue became more high profile over the last kind of 5 years or so, initially the interest of campaigners was in speaking to both the police and to local authorities about what could be done locally. And the reason we've ended up where we are now is a general consensus, a belief that the existing law and the existing powers given to councils in that instance wasn't adequate to deal with this. I just wonder if you could talk a little bit about the response to that those who've complained about protesters to the police in the past, the response that they've received is that there is no current law on the books that they are breaching, and therefore your officers are unable to take enforcement action unless very specific behaviours cross a line.
Yeah. I would agree that there's no existing legislation that really deals with the ethos of what this legislation is trying to achieve, as in it's trying to protect people that are legitimately accessing the healthcare services unhindered. Yes, there is legislation that if people go to these premises and protest and kind of cross a line of what would be acceptable in terms of criminality, which is always going to be open to some sort of interpretation, because it's going to depend on what the picture looks like, what the wording's like, or there's a whole lot of circumstance that's really going to kind of need to be considered as to whether a crime has been committed at that point. And then at that point we can take action. So I suppose what I'm trying to say is when there's protest, when it's actually happening and there's specific behaviours taking place, then yeah, we do have the legislation at that point to deal with that protest. But I would say what we don't have at the moment is legislation around that preventative element to create that safe space and for us to enforce that safe space, which would be through engagement and communication. So I do believe that gap does exist.
At present, if the protesters have arrived outside a facility, there are complaints, your officers are called, how would they deal with that under the law as it stands? So obviously, at the moment, it is entirely legal to stand on the road opposite the Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Glasgow or opposite Chalmers and protest. But very regularly, when those protests occur, your officers are called. How long would they attend for? What would they be looking for in that instance? Would they attend, speak to the protesters about what is and is not allowed and leave again? Would they stay for some time? Obviously, as part, protesters there for as it stands at the moment, 40 days. Your officers, I presume, are not going to attend the protest all day, every day for 40 days. So what does it actually look like when they're called out?
Yeah, so when they are called out, the officers will attend and essentially assess what it is that they're faced with. You know, if it is that kind of small number of protesters that we often see, say around a dozen, it's peaceful. Generally, we're quite content to have that engagement with them, find out their intentions, how long do they intend to stay, really get that feel that, you know, what we're seeing is that static, peaceful protest. We'd probably at that point be quite happy to leave them to it. Perhaps do some, you know, visit every 2 or 3 hours just to make sure that nothing's escalated. Engage with the premises as well, just to make sure that they're aware of the protest outside. If they see it escalating, then give them that reassurance that they can give us a call and we can take it from there. So, yeah, if it's peaceful, settled, static, generally we'll leave them to it with those sort of couple of safeguards in place in case it were to escalate beyond that.
Thanks. And just finally, Professor Cameron gave us an example in the last session of images being projected from a distance, but projected onto the facility. Now, I understand you might not want to talk about specific instances that have happened in the past, but as a generality, are your officers currently able to take any action in instances where somebody from a distance is projecting images of a fetus or anti-abortion messages, whatever it might be, onto the face of a hospital, or potentially actually, obviously, buildings have windows. Mm-hmm. Some of those images are actually entering the facility.
So, you know, we could attend the premises from where something's been projected and try and engage with the household or whatever it is and ask them to, you know, turn it off. But it would be essentially voluntary. We wouldn't have a power of entry in order to enforce that. That being said, probably as the legislation stands, I don't think we would have that power either. We would need to apply via the Procurator Fiscal to a sheriff to get a warrant to enter those premises to either seize the equipment or get it turned off.
Just clarifying that, what if they were doing it from a public highway rather than from a private property?
So that would be different. We could take action and seize equipment and consider the legislation or the bill as it stands at that point, yeah. But when it's in that private property, unless there was a specific power of entry in the legislation, then we would need to apply through Procurator Fiscal and Sheriff to gain access to that private property to take action.
Thanks very much. Really useful. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Ivan McGee.
Yeah, just a brief follow-up on that, if I may. Just a point of clarification, except we've got our briefing notes and it quotes from Police Scotland's submission and evidence, and just read out what it says. The bill has been reviewed and Police Scotland's position remains that existing powers and offences are sufficient to address unlawful behaviour which may arise in the vicinity of healthcare premises as a result of such protests. So I suppose I just want clarification on how that squares with what you just said to make sure that we understand for the record exactly what the position is, if that's okay.
Yeah, I was reading that. So it says in our original submission, it says to address any unlawful behaviour. I suppose the clarification for me to that is we're going to change what's lawful. So at the moment, standing silent outside a clinic isn't unlawful. So we wouldn't be able to take action round about that because it's not an offence. Whereas if we're trying to change what can actually take place outside a clinic in this bill, then makes that action unlawful.
Yeah.
We don't have the powers to deal with that.
Yeah, I suppose it's about tautology and it's about statement of the obvious, I suppose. If it's lawful, it's lawful. If it's not, it's not.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
I kind of see what you're saying, but I suppose just the way it comes across as a statement that you don't think more powers are required to deal with the situation. So thanks for that clarification. Okay, Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you all, and thanks for being here. I'm interested in issues around protected premises in the definition. And, you know, I know there's variability of healthcare provision across Scotland, so the 200-metre zone might need to be extended for certain parts of it. And I know that COSLA's submission says that COSLA expressed support for the provision to extend safe access zones as necessary, but talked previously in our briefing notes about further stakeholder engagement to explore how information about protected premises and their surrounding safe access zones could be effectively communicated to interest parties. So I'm interested in any thoughts about the definition of protected premises, whether 200 metres is, in your opinion, adequate. And I suppose, Eddie, I'll come to you first as COSLA.
In terms of the... Certainly, you know, I think there's probably a need for kind of wide engagement in general terms for this. But from a local authority perspective, you know, the feedback that we got from elected members, so we took this to two of our boards, the Communities Board, where elected members there representing local authorities and the Health and Social Care Board. And their interest was in, you know, there was actually a question, is 200 metres enough, you know, in some respects? So, but I know the bill has, there's a power in the bill to extend if need be, depending on, you know, the circumstances in each particular area, which we would support as well. But in general terms, we support that provision. So, but I probably don't have a lot of kind of detail on the specifics.
Okay. And we heard in the previous panel, Professor Cameron talked about persons having to come in through a back door and get escorted, and then that's that whole issue of, you know, access using IDs to open doors and things like that. So I suppose, Leslie, it would be, you know, your thoughts on the perimeter of establishing a safe access zone in order that people aren't approached or harassed, and which requires access through alternative than front door entry.
Yeah, so we were keen to keep it at 200 metres as well, and precisely for that point, because there's many accesses into different healthcare providers, and there isn't usually the way our hospitals as well as healthcare establishments are built nowadays and have been in the past 50 years. There's various different ways that people can enter. We wouldn't expect people who were coming in for hip operations, for example, to be taken in through a back door, as you say, so why should we expect anyone entering any sort of healthcare establishment for any access to services not to come in the area that you'd expected the public to walk into, because it gives the whole connotations around abortion services if you're going round through the back door. And different buildings have different entrances, and they may look different as you walk into staff entrances. They may not be as welcoming to the public. There may be storage facilities that are in. And for women accessing services like that, it doesn't give a value, really, around the healthcare that they're provided with. So that was why I think the key point as well about future-proofing healthcare is expanding and is hopefully moving towards a place which is much easier and right clear, right place, right time for people as well. And that doesn't necessarily mean that abortion services, as we've already heard, will always be within a hospital setting. Certainly in Tayside, the majority of medical abortions, which is under 12 weeks and given by medication, are provided, the medication's provided and is undertaken at home, in home as well. So whilst at the moment we provide that medication through a hospital setting, in the future that may not be. It could be a pharmacy, could be GP surgeries, it could be clinics, it could be different kinds of providers that we're moving. So I think we need to be able to protect those as well.
So the future-proofing aspect of the provisions in the bill need to make sure that there's flexibility to allow, for instance, if GP practices or pharmacies or other areas could then be included based on application and then ministerial approval. So is there anything missing at the moment in the bill about expanding or even reducing premises, for instance?
I think the flexibility is the key word that you talk about, and probably the pace of what the application can be put to ministers and can be approved on as well, because I suppose what we don't know, what we don't know always, and whilst we are trying to future-proof things, it may be that protesters decide other areas as well, such as GP surgeries, and 200 metres round a GP surgery does seem quite a significant amount, considering who else would be entering the premises for those things and that right to peacefully protest. But if the pace of the application can be put through a rapid response, that would be flexible enough.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for being with us. I have some questions about criminal offences and penalties, which I think will probably mostly be for Jerry Corrigan, Simon Brown, but if other panel members wish to come in, I'm happy to hear from them. There have been some concerns raised from opponents of the bill that the behaviour captured in Section 4 is wide-ranging and unclear. What are your views on the clarity of the offence? Simon?
I think Section 4.1, I think influencing is the one that will cause the biggest difficulties. I don't think prevention or impeding would be in need of much clarification, and certainly harassment, alarm or distress would convene existing laws as we have at present. Influencing is going to pose a problem, and I think on that basis, to make the legislation a success, you're going to have to focus much more on an exclusion zone, and any behaviour within that exclusion zone being an offence if it's designed for the purposes of influencing other people. That should be relatively easy to establish, because by their nature these people are coming to protest, and whilst we are hearing the scare stories of so-and-so will be arrested for praying silently in the street, the protests that I've seen so far have involved placards and banners and posters, because they're obviously trying to make a point. And if you can identify somebody as making a point of a protest, and you could identify them as making a point of a protest within an exclusion zone, then I wouldn't foresee a difficulty in prosecuting that. I think, speaking from a defence point of view, I think that would be hard to defend.
OK. Do you have anything to add?
Yeah. I mean, my sense is that in reading Section 4.1, to take that out operationally, in terms of the protests that I've seen at the Queen Elizabeth, for example, it feels competent. Take Simon's point around about the influence and that, and the word influencing. There's perhaps a bit of interpretation within that, but my sense is it would take a bit of writing in the police report to the Procurator Fiscal to outline overall circumstances, for example, silent prayer. And how that could have the effect of influencing, so it feels competent.
Okay. On that point about silent prayer, we heard from the previous panel about how even, you know, that can cause distress and anxiety and impede people going into clinics. How would a police officer determine what somebody was praying about silently?
Well, yeah, I mean, so I guess in terms of that, and in providing evidence to the prosecutor in terms of what the person was doing, it would really just need to be a physical description of the person's demeanour, as opposed to going into the realms of perhaps what they were thinking.
Mm. Do Police Scotland have any concerns about enforcing legislation that was around what somebody was thinking?
Yes, yes. I'm certain that isn't an area that we would go to or encroach upon or ask about or try and describe at all. That's an area we would stay clear of.
Okay. Do you think that the offences in the bill have a lower evidential requirement than in comparison to existing offences? The example was relating to harassment or threatening behaviour.
My sense is, you know, it's broadly comparable to the description of a breach of the peace or the statutory breach of the peace. So, in my sense, it feels comparable to that. So, it covers it.
Okay, thank you, that's helpful. Section 5 of the bill is going to create an offence relating to behaviour from property within a safe access zone but not covered by it, which could be seen or heard from the safe access zone. Are there any existing offences which are similar in nature? And do you have any opinion on the proportionality of this measure?
I can't think of anything that's similar in nature. I mean, if you're talking about the example that was given earlier of projecting something onto a building, I think, as an aside to talk about that specifically, I think that would still be an offence under the terms of this legislation, because it's creating an influence within the exclusion zone, because the impact of the behaviour is within the exclusion zone. I can't think of anything, as the law currently stands, that where behaviour outside influences behaviour inside, it would be a crime. But I think, as Gerry says, I mean, if you look at the general terms of Section 38, which is statute of breach of the peace, or breach of the peace itself, which probably in these particular situations would be more relevant, because it's more of a subjective test from the complainer saying, I was placed in a state of fear and alarm, then I think a lot of the conduct that's envisaged to be captured by this bill would be captured by it. I think, just to go back briefly to your earlier point as well about silent prayer, I would not anticipate you're going to get people leading a defence of, I was not committing an offence, I was thinking about my shopping list. These are people who are here to protest, who are going to say, I was here to protest, this is what I was doing. And going on from that, these are people who will always take a case to trial, who I would imagine will not pay a financial penalty and will seek to be imprisoned to raise awareness of what they're saying. I think that's a likely outcome here.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was just going to come in on the point about items being displayed in private property. You know, so if there was a contentious march, for example, through a city centre and someone is displaying a flag of the opposing side in their private property, probably that's going to be an offence under breach of the peace. So not sort of specific legislation as such, but given the behaviour it could incite within those in the march, it could be a breach of the peace. So I suppose it's not entirely unique.
Thank you. We heard on the earlier panel concerns that the fine element, and I think Simon sort of alluded to this in his answer as well, that the fine element could be paid by what are sometimes quite well-funded anti-abortion groups, so that it's not actually going to act as a deterrent. Do any of the panel members have a view on that? I'll come to you first, Simon, as you mentioned.
That's almost certainly the case. I think it's unlikely any of these protesters will be paying it themselves. But I think, to go back to what I said earlier, I think it's unlikely they'll pay a fine. I think if you look back at the closest analogy I can give is the protesters against nuclear submarines. I mean, I think, and also some of the Stop Oil protesters in England and Wales, they don't pay the fine because they will then be imprisoned for not paying a fine, and that gets your headlines of imprisoned for praying silently. That's the whole point of the...
Does anyone else have anything to add on that? And one final question, Convener, if I may. The Police Scotland response noted that the fine only approach had implications for power of arrest. Could you explain, just for the record, what those implications might be and how that might influence decisions on enforcement of these laws?
Yeah, so I note the bill itself doesn't have a power of arrest, or is silent in terms of power of arrest round about protesters, which is fine, and that's something that we can work with. So, in my sense, the power of arrest is still there. The fact that it's a fine, we just need to be considerate in terms of how serious the offence is when we're thinking about custodial outcomes from the police custody.
Okay.
And whether they're going to court and how quickly that person's being released.
Are you able to expand on that a bit and just maybe give an example? I know it's difficult because this is a new thing, but if...
Yeah, so generally now we have a presumption of liberty.
Okay.
We try and not arrest, either by using other means or release people from custody very quickly. However, protest is slightly different, because obviously if we arrest someone at a protest, take them back to a police office and release them, then they can just go back to the protest and obviously that's not working. So probably practically, if a person were to be arrested at a protest, we try now and keep them in custody until the protest itself is finished, certainly for that day, to avoid that instance where the person just goes back to the protest. However, we probably would not keep them in custody for court the next day because I suppose the fine is indicating that it's a relatively minor offence.
OK, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
So, Ivan McKee, do you have any further questions?
I think that's all been covered.
Perfect.
Thanks.
OK. Then we move on to Dr. Sandesh Gilhani.
Thank you. Just a question of interest as a practising NHS GP. Sarah, can I start with you, if I may? So I asked this question in the last panel, but I was approached, the reason I asked it was because I was approached by somebody who works within an abortion service. And she said to me that she has and knows of other members of staff who have been put off calling the police because they don't want their names associated regularly with complaining and being out there. So is that something you recognise as potentially an issue?
I wouldn't have thought so. I mean, we're fortunate in Aberdeen, we haven't had to contact our local police, but I would have thought that if it's a staff member, it's part of the job. I wonder if there could be a possibility of being recorded as NHS Grampian rather than an individual staff member. I wonder if there's any precedent for doing that, whether that would remove those concerns. But I would have thought our team would feel that that is, yes, part of the role, and to be on record for having made that call. Whether we would rotate amongst us so different people would call different times. We haven't felt that would be a problem. Okay. If the protest is happening, it's part of the job to reporter.
Thank you. That neatly comes on to my question to Simon and to Gerry. Is it the case that you have to have somebody down as the named person that's made the complaint? Or, as Sarah just said, could it be the department or the area or the place for this legislation?
I don't think you need a named complainer, but if the case proceeds to trial, you need a witness. You need somebody to come to court and say, I saw person X doing behaviour Y. Now, in theory, depending on how the Act's ultimately worded, if the exclusion zone is an exclusion zone and it becomes an offence to simply protest within that, then in theory, if you have good CCTV coverage and you can see that the person is within the zone holding a placard, clearly protesting, that should be sufficient to run a prosecution, I would think. Looking at it from a defence point of view, I would find that hard to argue. But if you're saying that someone was upset by conduct, then ordinarily in a breach of the peace case, you will need somebody to come to court and say, I was upset by that conduct.
I think, yes, absolutely. But if it's a clear, you know, if you turn up with a placard, let's say there's no CCTV, but you do need witnesses. But could it be the department makes the complaint and then the witnesses then would be the people that would then come forward to further that case?
You need to ask the fiscal's office about that to get. But speaking from a defence point of view, I don't see how that would be a difficulty. I mean, if you have evidence being presented, I mean, for example, CCTV is normally presented as evidence and gathered by the local authority and it's normally agreed because the local authority provides a certificate to say our CCTV operator took that CCTV. So, yes, in theory, I could see no difficulty with just a named, you know, organisation saying we provided CCTV. But if you're going above and beyond that, if you're talking about subjective conduct being complained about, you would need somebody to speak to what that conduct was.
Thank you.
Likewise, so we don't need a name if someone phones in. That's not required. I probably would also add, you know, if someone does phone, it can be anonymous, but you know, if that person that phones and says 100 metres away I can see 20 people gathered, they're probably not witnessing any one specific person doing anything. And the reason I mention that is when the police do arrive, it may be that the evidence for the prosecution is solely coming from the police officers and isn't actually coming from the person that phoned in.
Yeah, but that's, I mean, I've seen trials like that where police officers will view CCTV and say, I have viewed the CCTV and I can see person A committing this offence and that's person A in court. So they don't have to actually see the offence itself. That would be competent.
OK, thank you very much. I just want to go back to the question about silent prayer, because obviously, you know, we've already heard from questions that it has been described to us at a previous session about the impact that that's had to people. So if you are called to say there is five people standing in a circle, how can you as the police go and deal with that if you're not going to sort of ask them what they're doing and ask them if they're protesting and ask them if they are praying?
So I think, you know, in terms of the bill, I think the police officer has, in the report to the Procurator Fiscal, is probably going to need to describe that picture that you've kind of illustrated there. You know, it's the overall circumstances, the location of where the people are at, their demeanour, how they're standing, are there any other signs, or placards, etc. And it's really painting that picture of what the people are actually doing. I don't think, you know, I really don't think we could go down the road of asking them what are they thinking or what their thoughts are. You know, that feels really uncomfortable. Even asking them why they're here at that point in time, probably from a defence point of view as well, is beginning to question them to try and complete the crime, which is also kind of fraught with difficulties as well, because we're getting into the realms of interviewing them at the location without offering them legal advice or cautioning them. So there's quite a there's some difficulties there.
Specifically about that, if one was stopped driving a car, are the police officers not entitled to ask, do you know why I've stopped you? Is that not similar?
Yeah, so, you don't have to answer.
Yeah. that shouldn't be asked from that. So, going back to the protest, if we're asking them why they're there, what are they thinking, at that point we're beginning to gather evidence that's going to help with the prosecution case. Probably if a police officer stops a car and asks the driver, do you know why I stopped you? It's probably more of a conversational piece as opposed to actually trying to gather evidence to complete the criteria of the crime.
Okay, right. Thank you. I suppose the last question that I would like to ask is, in your opinion, and this is very subjective seeing as we haven't done it yet, but in your opinion, do you feel that the bill, in the way that it is written, will provide women and staff who will be attending abortion clinics the protections that it intends to? And if not, what would you like to see added or taken away?
I think the bill, as it's written, should go a long way to providing the relevant protections. I think there will be practical things that will have to be done. I think if you've got a clearly delineated exclusion zone, that will be a big help. I think, as I've already said, CCTV will be a big help. If you've got both of those things in practice, it should render prosecutions relatively straightforward. If you'd ask if there's one thing I could add, I think you should be looking at something similar to the current provisions in relation to domestic abuse, where non-harassment orders can be granted. Because once you've had a conviction of a person, I think you would like the position for the prosecutor to ask the court to impose an order on that person not to go within an exclusion zone in any hospital for a period of time, and that would provide the police with a reason to arrest a person simply for being there without doing anything, and that would over time should cut down on the number of protesters.
Yes, I agree. It goes a long way to providing that safe space for women to access the services. Certainly there was protesters at the Queen Elizabeth yesterday. I'm sure if this bill was passed and in, then quite frankly they wouldn't be there. So I guess there's a difference. generally the people that protest around this topic are law-abiding. So, you know, I think they would take cognizance of this and adjust their protest site accordingly, which would then create that safe space.
Thank you.
Ross Graham.
Convener, just following up on this point around silent prayer and intent, so that I'm understanding this correctly, because what I'm trying to figure out in my head is how unprecedented the proposals here are, because that's the argument some folk are making. And the comparison I was drawing in my head, and understand it's not like for like, is around stalking and harassment. It's not illegal to stand silently outside somebody else's house, but if you're doing it as part of a pattern of behaviour where you are stalking that individual, that, my understanding is that's already an offence under the law. So police officers are already being asked to make judgments around intent in not entirely dissimilar circumstances, are they not?
Yeah, so I guess the issue on silent prayer, so I don't think we can provide opinion. I think we need to provide facts round about prosecution. So I think all we can really provide is you know, a picture of what it is that we actually see. It's someone standing silently, solemnly, and describe their demeanour, what their body language or what their body's actually doing. And I suppose why, and in terms of the bill, why that would be intimidating for someone attending an abortion clinic, and why that may potentially influence their decision as to whether they proceed with that, and bringing in the overall circumstances of it being the abortion clinic. I just don't think we can possibly start entering into what that person's thoughts were or what their...
Yeah, I suppose I probably didn't word that particularly well. I suppose what I'm saying is I appreciate entirely that were this bill to pass, it would be asking police officers to do something that is relatively difficult. But the point I was trying to get at is, do we not already ask that of the police in a range of other circumstances where there does need to be some attempt to understand the intent? So like the example I'm given of, you can stand silently outside somebody's house and it's not a crime, but if you're doing it as part of a pattern of behaviour where you are stalking and harassing the individual in that house, that's part of an offence. And we already ask police officers to make those kind of judgments. In the first instance, obviously, we then ask fiscal and the courts.
Yeah, I mean, the harassment and domestic abuse is probably a good example of that. If an ex-partner was standing silently outside someone's house, clearly that feels intimidating. There's comparisons to that.
Thanks. No, that's useful. This was partly just so that I could understand in my head, with my lack of familiarity with other areas of the law, just how unprecedented this is. But no, that was useful. Thank you.
David Orns.
Good morning to witnesses. Mr Brown, this is for you. And it's around human rights issues. Does the bill balance competing rights under the European Convention of Human Rights, and do you think it does it successfully?
I think it does. I would imagine that any final wording of the bill is going to be very similar to the legislation that was passed in Northern Ireland. The legislation that was passed in Northern Ireland has been tested against the ECHR and the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court said it's compatible. So if it's worded similarly to that, I fully anticipate it will be. I can't see there being a difficulty. The right to protest is enshrined in ECHR, but there are limits placed upon that. And as I said, the Supreme Court, and from memory, I think there are at least two Scottish judges sitting in the Supreme Court. I think Lord Reid was sitting, Lord Galloway was sitting, and they viewed that the restrictions are appropriate within the context. So the short answer is, if it's in a similar form to the Irish legislation, I can't see why it would not be ECHR compatible.
Thank you for that. Can I quickly go back to silent prayer? Because I've got a real problem with this. If somebody stand or a group is standing there and they're asked what they're doing, and they turn around and say, look, on religious beliefs, I'm praying for a man to marry or whatever, how are you going to prove differently? Are you ever going to get a conviction for that?
But I think that's true, but I think to go back to the analogy that Mr. Greer used about stalkers, when I'm, and again, I'm a defence listener, I'm not a prosecutor, but when I'm defending somebody with those charges, inevitably the defence will be, I was not stalking. I was standing there having a cigarette. I was standing there checking my messages. I wasn't stalking. In these situations, I think you're talking about people who are actively going there to protest and will accept the fact that they are there to protest. Otherwise, there's no point in doing so. I don't think you're going to get people who are going to say, I wasn't here to protest against abortion. I was here, like, as you say, to pray for my Auntie Mary, or else what's the point of them being there? So, whilst I could see that being, in theory, a difficulty in the particular circumstances that I think we're likely to be dealing with, I don't think it'll arise because people are going there to protest. They're going to say they're there to protest.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Ruth McGuire, do you have any further questions?
I was just thinking there.
No problem. Sandesh Gahani.
Thank you. Just for the record, let's take the LGML case, and I want to go and protest outside NHS Tayside about Professor LGML or things that have been happening and say this is unacceptable. I would be breaching a 200-metre zone, obviously, because I'd be trying to get as close to the hospital as I can. But are you absolutely happy that that protest will not fall in any way under this bill?
Actions influence people going for abortions. They don't know why you're there. So if actions influence them, then they might.
I imagine I'd have a sign about LGML.
No, I don't think there. I don't think there is a distinction. Looking at it from the person that's accessing the services point of view, you know, their approach and the premises, and they're probably all they're going to see from a distance is someone or other people with placards, and probably at that point that you know they'll take it within themselves that's what the protest is about rather than something else. I think there is a difficulty if the protest is for something completely different.
Thank you. I mean, that to me is a huge concern. It's obvious if you're going to the Chalmers Centre in Edinburgh, because there's only so many things that they provide there. But if I turn up outside a big hospital that provides a lot of services and I want to protest against other issues within that hospital, I'm not sure that that's the point of this bill, to try to stop that from happening. So is there any mitigations or ways that we could prevent those protests from, in your opinion, being part of this bill?
You would have to give some freedom to the Procurator Fiscal to take a reasoned decision. You can't make it an absolute offence. You make it an absolute offence, then anything's going to be caught in it. And one of the examples when we were talking about this before I came today, in theory, if you're talking about a busy entrance to a hospital, a mother pushing a newborn baby in to receive prenatal care could be viewed as influencing somebody who's going for an abortion because she sees that newborn baby. But when the two are entirely unrelated, they have nothing to do. So you have to give some prosecutorial discretion to think, actually, that's not what this is for, and I'm not going to prosecute that. And provided you allow that element of discretion, there shouldn't be a problem. Other than that, protests presumably can be agreed in advance and can be agreed to be in a particular area and not, hopefully not through the two overlapping.
Okay. Would it be possible for you to write to us with perhaps some ways of wording that?
No, I could do that, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. M. Harper.
Thank you. Just to pick up on that, in the previous panel, we had Colin Pullman from RCN. And so if there was a labour dispute, as we've seen, and if I was approaching the service to the hospital to receive a service, but I did see placards, folks standing in scrubs or whatever. So that we would need to make sure that some language in the bill allows the unions to make a protest about wages or terms and conditions or whatever. But that is, how would we make sure that if I was approaching from a distance, I don't assume it's an anti-abortion protest?
I don't know how you can do that. I mean, I think there's already a provision in the Act about the Trade Union Act for peaceful picketing, so
yeah.
You could no doubt expand on that for other protests. I mean, I think you're moving away from legal terms to reality. I think there is no way in reality you can stop, you can control what somebody who's going to access a hospital thinks when they see a group of people 300 or 400 yards away that they don't know what they're doing. You know, that's just life. But if somebody who's accessing these services is aware that when they're accessing services there will be no one there specifically trying to target them, then that must, to some extent, ease their mind.
Right. So that would provide assurance.
Yeah.
Bringing forward this legislation would provide assurance for people accessing healthcare services that they will not encounter protests influencing them accessing the service.
You can't stop somebody thinking, I don't know if that's a protest or a group of people waiting for a bus because it's 500 yards away, but all you can do is make it easier. Mm-hmm. I don't think you can ever eliminate the problems.
Okay.
Thank you. Is there any other issues in relation to the bill that haven't been covered in questioning by members that you wish to express a view on? Yes.
I had a question about one of the exceptions. I think it's in section 6. I'm not sure if I understood what it was getting at. I think it was that you're an exception if you were another person working within the premises, the protected premises. And I wasn't sure what thinking was behind that, because it struck me that could mean, and I hope it wouldn't happen, that say in a hospital, say a cardiology team could protest within the hospital and they would be an exception, but I may be completely misunderstanding that clause.
Thanks, we'll certainly note that point in trying to establish more detail around that potential intersection. Is there any other points that witnesses would like to raise? If I may, I'd just like to touch on the financial provisions of the bill and what financial impacts the bill could have. And just to ask the witnesses, do you feel that the anticipated financial impact of the bill is proportionate to its purpose? Does anyone have a particular view on that? Mr Brown?
I don't have a particular view. I would imagine you're not going to be talking about a huge amount of prosecutions given the level of protests we've seen at present. I would have thought in the tens would be likely, rather than anything over and above that.
Okay. Is there any... Yes, Mr Fulham?
And just for the record, you know, from a local authority perspective, there are no financial implications for us, in it.
Okay.
We would have a small implication in terms of training and bringing people up to speed, but it's relatively straightforward, so I see it as minimal.
Okay, thanks for that points of clarification. And on that, really, unless there's any other further points from any of our members... happy to rest on that. Thank you very much for witnesses' attendance today. Really appreciate your contribution to the committee's work. And with that, we'll move on to the next item of business, which is subordinate legislation. We have 4 negative instruments in front of the committee today. The first instrument is the National Health Service Optical Charges and Payments and General Ophthalmic Services Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. The purpose of the instrument is to increase by an overall of 1.68% the values of NHS optical vouchers accepted or used by a supplier in Scotland on and after 1st of April 2024. It also brings into effect various administrative changes relating to the provision of general ophthalmic services, otherwise known as GOS, on and after 1st of April 2024. The policy note states that the NHS optical vouchers provide financial help towards the purchase of new glasses or contact lenses for eligible persons, including children aged under 16, those aged 16 to 18 and qualifying full-time education, those on a low income and those who require complex lenses. Some people are also eligible for an NHS optical voucher for help with the cost of repairing or replacing glasses or contact lenses. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 27th of February and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. No motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. I ask if any members have comments to make in relation to this statutory instrument. Therefore, I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree? I see no disagreement. Thank you. I can confirm that. The second instrument is The National Health Service Common Staffing Methods Scotland Regulations 2024. The purpose of the instrument is to specify the minimum frequency at which the common staffing method is to be used in relation to specific types of healthcare and the staffing level and professional judgment tools that must be used as part of the common staffing method for specified kinds of healthcare provision. The policy note states that the instrument is required to specify that the common staffing method must be used no less than once annually in relation to certain types of healthcare. The regulations also specify the specialty-specific staffing levels tools and the professional judgment tool that should be used as part of the common staffing method for specified kinds of healthcare provision. 10 specialty-specific staffing level tools are named in the instrument alongside the particular kind of healthcare provision for which each tool is to be used. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 27th of February this year and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. No motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Members will, however, note that the Royal College of Nursing has written to the committee raising certain specific concerns in relation to the drafting of this instrument. The letter for the Royal College of Nursing raises a number of wider issues that the committee may wish to consider as part of its future post-legislative scrutiny of the Health and Care Staffing Scotland Act of 2019. In relation to the correspondence we have received, I therefore propose that we write to the Scottish Government requesting that they address the specific points raised by the Royal College of Nursing and to consider that instrument at a future meeting. Do members agree with the proposed action? Agreed. Thank you. That's great. The third instrument we are considering this morning is the Personal Injuries NHS Charges Amounts Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. The purpose of the instrument is to amend the Personal Injuries NHS Charges Amounts Scotland Regulations of 2006. The instrument will increase the charges, otherwise known as NHS charges, recovered from persons who pay compensators in cases where an injured person receives National Health Service hospital treatment or ambulance services. The increase in charges relates to an uplift for Hospital and Community Health Service HCHS annual inflation. The policy note states that the instrument will allow for new NHS charges to apply in cases where compensation has been made in respect to incidents occurring on or after the 1st of April 2024, with NHS charges being revised annually to take account of the Hospital and Community Health Services pay and price inflation. The scheme is administered on behalf of the Scottish Ministers by the Compensation Recovery Unit of the Department of Work and Pensions in accordance with an agency arrangement under Section 93 of the 1998 Scotland Act. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 27th of February this year and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. No motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have a comment to make in relation to the statutory instrument? No. Therefore, I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree? No. Okay. So we then move on to the fourth and final instrument, which is the Social Care and Social Work Improvement Cancellation of Registration and Relevant Requirements Order of 2024. The purpose of the instrument is to ensure that the Care Inspectorate can propose to cancel the registration of a care service under Section 64(1) of the Public Services Reform Scotland Act 2010, otherwise known as the 2010 Act, or report a certain local authority provided care services to the Scottish Ministers under Section 91(3)(Bravo) of the 2010 Act, following a breach of Section 7 and/or 8 of the Health and Care Staffing Scotland 2019 Act. The 2019 Act comes into force on the 1st of April 2024. The policy note states that the instrument specifies new grounds on which the Care Inspectorate may propose to cancel the registration of a care service, namely that the service is being or has at any time been carried on other than in accordance with Section 7 and/or Section 8 of the 2019 Act. It also specifies the requirements imposed by Sections 7 and 8 of the 2019 Act as relevant requirements for the purposes of a Section 91(5)(Charlie) of the 2010 Act. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on 27 February this year and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. No motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments to make in relation to this instrument? No. Therefore, I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree? No. Okay. We've confirmed agreement. At our next meeting on the 12th of March, we will continue taking evidence as part of the committee's stage one scrutiny of the Abortion Services Safe Access Zone Scotland Bill. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you.